form, but I promise that we do okay. And I also want to say sorry that we don't have enough chairs for everyone, but just, you know, feel free to move around, feel free to stand, to sit, to do whatever you need to do. I want you to be relaxed and just say thank you for being here.
Come to me, all that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Good afternoon. Indeed, it is a testament to Alex's life to have so many friends and family here, so many loved ones. I've been asked today to read several things, and also later in the service I'm supposed to sing a song to you along with Diane Gore. So I decided that the scripture that I'd like to read to you is a scripture that is related to that song that we're to sing. It is a scripture about salvation, even though it is written in Old Testament times. And I'll give a little explanation of a point of it afterwards. Salvation and the protection afforded by the Lord. Psalm 91. The one who lives under the protection of the Most High dwells in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. He himself will deliver you from the hunter's net, from the destructive plague. He will cover you with his feathers. You will take refuge under his wings. His faithfulness will be a protective shield. You will not fear the terror of the night, the arrow that flies by day, the plague that stalks in darkness, or the pestilence that ravages at noon. Though 1,000 fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, the pestilence will not reach you. You will only see it with your eyes and witness the punishment of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord, my refuge, the Most High, your dwelling place, no harm will come to you. No plague will come near your tent. For he will give his angels orders concerning you to protect you in all your ways. They will support you with their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the cobra. You will trample the young lion and the serpent. The psalm then turns, and we hear the voice of the Lord speak. Because he is lovingly devoted to me, I will deliver him. I will protect him because he knows my name. When he calls out to me, I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and give him honor. I will satisfy him with a long life and show him my salvation. As we come to the end of that, I realize that we talk about God guaranteeing long life. And we're here to remember someone who died at the age of 26. It doesn't seem to apply, does it? Yet we must remember, and this is the most important thing that we must remember at a time like this, life does not end here. We are guaranteed not only a long life here in this environment, but an eternal and abundant life. All who call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. I have heard. I know he was a very troubled young man. But I have heard Alex call on the name of the Lord. I've been asked also to read from this bulletin that you have here, the special memories section. These are some things about Alex and also about the bulletin itself. Alex was named in honor of the Alexander family name. The pictures on the front of the bulletin are from Alex's Facebook page and include his many loves. the Emerson quote, "Live in the sunshine, swim in the sea, drink the wild air," from Ralph Waldo Emerson. And the picture is very familiar to me. I've probably been to this very place. It looks like EOP in Florida. Alex loved the beach and lived for a long time in Florida. His dog, Mata, his Clemson Tiger ring and the car tag, and his lovely wife, Laura, are all shown on the front. Alex was passionate about football and especially the Clemson Tigers. He rarely missed watching a game and often posted his dedication to the team, win or lose. He loved bowling with the Seneca Bowling Association and received the 700 Series Award and the 2012 Sportsmanship Award. Bowled with him a number of times there. And it's something to bowl against Alex. You don't have a chance. He was on the Valhalla High School golf team and continued to enjoy amateur mini golf throughout his life. Several of the pictures were professionally taken during his time at the Carolina Talent Modeling Agency. The photos on the inside of the bulletin include a family picture in 2013, his grandmother, Mary Alexander, a picture of him with his cousin Paige and second cousin Dash, wearing football helmets here with his niece Amy Kay, and sporting his Clemson champion shirt with his nephew Andrew. On the back, the family picture was taken 5 months ago at Alex's birthday in November, the first time that they'd all been together in the same place for over 10 years. He earned his South Carolina insurance license in 2013 and attended Tri-County Technical College before that. Thank you again for being here to honor Alex. I will see you again in a few minutes. And right now I'd like to bring back up Angie.
I turned 18 and graduated high school, and Mom turned 40 and found that she was pregnant with Alex all in a matter of weeks. The doctor, Mom and I were in the delivery room together when she pushed 3 times, no joke, and Alex popped into our world. And I have to say that her pushing 3 times set me up for quite a bit of disappointment and unrealistic expectations of my own delivery a few short years later. But I was 18 and suddenly I literally had a baby brother. I moved out so Alex could have my bedroom and I watched it change from yellow with little hearts and rainbows to miniature football helmets, tiger paw onesies, and child-sized footballs. And so a passion for Clemson and football was born. And I chose to honor him today with those same colors and in that spirit and theme. Most people don't know this, but I named him his middle name of Sheldon. People ask me why I named him Sheldon. All I can say is it was the 80s. And at that time, I was planning on naming my own son Landon without thinking that my husband might want some input on that in the future. So in my mind, it was going to be Sheldon and Landon, but it turned out to be Alex and Andrew, and that's much better. Alex was a ring bearer in my wedding, and there's a picture in the back of us where he's just about to give me a kiss on the steps, and it just shows you the range of our age difference, that, you know, he would be able to participate in my wedding as the little child. And you never knew what Alex was going to say. And so when Andrew was born, my son Andrew was born, Alex became an uncle at 7. And so they were only 7 years apart. And you never knew what Alex was going to say at a young age. And so my son, he would come and visit us in Tennessee, and my son and I, we were at the Tennessee Prairie, Willow Purple Family. they weren't, and they had a blast doing it. One time, Mom and Amy Kay was a baby at that point, they came to visit, and we went out shopping, and we left Alex and Andrew and Daddy and Anthony at home. So right about the time we got back in the door, Anthony thought, it was really quiet in there, because they were playing in one of the rooms, and he went in to check on them about the same time we walked through the door, and they had covered the entire nursery in baby powder. They looked like it had snow, they had it all over them, they had it all over everything, but it's those times that you're like, how am I going to get this cleaned up? But you look back later and you think, you know, they had a blast pretending it was snowing in the nursery, I'm sure. Alex's laughter was infectious, even if it was at your own expense, and you couldn't help but laughing along with him. He was my baby brother, but I didn't grow up with Alex like I did with Lane. Lane and I are only 3 years apart. My feelings towards Alex was much more maternal due to our age differences. I loved him, and I told him that as often as I could. And all this week, as I worked on this service and planned it out, I put together things I thought Alex would like. But I had a motto for myself, kind of a theme that kept taking place, and I want to share that with you today, because that will give you an idea of where we're wanting to go with this today. This is a celebration of life. It's not a rehashing of the past or a retelling of the tragedy. We are here to celebrate everything Alex did well and did wonderfully and what he meant to us in this time. Funerals make us look at our own life. And one of my favorite songs is a quote from Andrew Peterson in it. It says, life is not long, but it's hard. For Alex, life was too hard, not long enough. And most of us will choose our death date, but none of us are guaranteed tomorrow. And like all of these beautiful fronts of these mausoleums here that we see, there's a space between each one or a dash. And how you choose to fill up that space between your birth date and your death date is up to you. Foster peace, seek out beautiful things, do something good daily. Live your refrigerator magnets, the ones about dancing like no one's watching and seize the day and something about being skinny. Get help, talk to someone. Proverbs 11:14, where there's no guidance, the people fall, but in abundance of counselors, there's victory. The current saying I have on my chalkboard at home is, you don't find the happy life, you make it. Do what you can with God's help to make it the best space that you can between that birth date and the death date. And I want to say from my family to yours, thank you for being here today and helping us celebrate Alex.
But I enjoyed him, I never forgot him, and I thank you for letting me as rough you can be with him, he always came back for more. He was the perfect kid for a high schooler, a high school male. We had a ball when he was a kid. Later on in my life, I disappeared for several years. That's my regret. But I didn't know Alex that much as an adult. I did spend some time with him last year, and I was proud of the person he was becoming. It seemed like he was working hard at being better at what he could do. He was married and enjoying that, really enjoying that. So I just want to everybody know that I'm proud of him. Like to read something from Celebration of Family. What a journey. Sometimes adventurous, sometimes exhilarating, many times sad, now an unexpected tragedy. All in a moment of time. I do want to thank the family for their love and support for the years. It was hard for them to realize the condition and disease of his mind. They traveled through the hard times, enjoyed the good, and often couldn't understand the bad. They were always there trying to fix, like everyone else, and men. But we just didn't know, we just couldn't help them. I couldn't help them. So we want to thank Angie, Lane, Brandon, Kay, Daphne, Joy, Becky, Daryl, Anthony, Amy, Kay, Andrew, and especially his wife, Laura, for all that they've done for us. But most of all, we want to thank my mother and father, who devoted their time to his welfare. This is where he loves now, starting with his family. He joined them once again. In loving memory of Alex, my mother would like to present to you something.
And I know that you guys are going to say there is never a time this woman doesn't speak. But this is very, really important, because all the years that we tried to do what we could do, we were always saying, we can fix this. Finally, we took an online class, which somebody's going to bring up later, and we finally realized that we had to really deal with someone who had a mental illness, and that it was true, and it could happen to you. It can happen to your family. It can happen to you. Yesterday, someone brought me something by, and I thought it was just fabulous, and they said, "We do not know what he was thinking, but this is close. This is as close to what he could have been thinking." So I'm going to try to read this to you. "It means feeling like you are forever swimming against the tide. Sometimes you find a gentle current where you can enjoy your very existence, only to be overtaken by a horrific undercurrent that makes you fight the water for your life. There are times you're just too tired to swim, and you begin to drown, hoping someone will save you. And maybe they do, but they cannot get you out of the water. Eventually, you care enough about them to let them go. Or they become so weary, they have to let you go." And this is maybe what he was thinking. I've got to do this. I've got to save my family. I've got to save my marriage. I've got to save it. So he was a beautiful child, and we have a whole lot of pictures. I guess you can see them.
I would just like to say that it's a real honor for us to be here with the family. And Alex was like a son to us. And even though we hadn't seen much of him over the last few years, our family traveled quite a bit, pastoring churches, etc. We've got many good memories when Alex would come around and visit with our family. Our son Christian, who is on a church planting mission in New Zealand, has written some thoughts about memories he had as he spent time with Alex. And he was probably one of his closest brothers in Christ. And I'd just like to share some thoughts to you from Christian. He couldn't be here, of course. He's halfway around the world. So, pardon me, I'm going to read much of this, because this is actually words that our son Christian penned in memory of Alex. He says, "When I think about my dear friend Alex, I think of a guy who was much more than a friend. He was my brother. We met when we were in middle school, but didn't start hanging out so much until we were getting closer to our high school years. Something that really brought us together was basketball. Alex loved sports, watching them, playing them. He loved his Clemson Tigers and was their biggest fan. He was at times a very shy guy, but when he got to the end of his teen years, I think he really began to come out of his shell and be more free to express his mind and ideas. We had a great group of friends during those high school years. We all shared one common bond. We met a great friend and brother in Alex. Alex was a guy who loved to have a good time. He was a joy to be around. Most times, and Christian said wink, and would laugh like no one else I know, and that was mentioned earlier. It wasn't just a laugh, it was more of an ongoing chuckle, followed by him busting out laughing uncontrolled. He was a very smiling guy. He loved to travel and listen to music really loud, with the windows down. He was always an encouragement to me when it came to my singing. He always said I was a good singer and had the potential to be really great if I just kept applying myself. And Christian says right now he's doing music as one of his main ministry focuses. And he wants to thank Alex for his encouragement in that very thing. His words will always stick with me and be something I look to when I feel like I need them. He was a kind soul to me, and even though we didn't agree on some things, we always ended up hanging out together because we both enjoyed the quality time we shared. He was a lot smarter than I think some people gave him credit for. He excelled in school and did very well for himself no matter what job he took or obstacle life took him through. He had so much energy and love for people, especially during the times we spent in those late teen and early 20 years together. Alex was a dreamer. He had dreams to explore. He had plans to do big things and make a real mark for himself. I'll never forget our late night runs to Walmart just to walk around because at that time, none of us had much else to do. Daniel Moody would whistle at someone down an aisle and the rest of us would get stuck like deer in headlights with people thinking we whistled at them. I remember our fun times bowling together and trips to Greenville to see what kind of exciting things the city might offer that day. I think of the times Ronnie would take us guys out to breakfast and all the fun, playful remarks there were between the father and son. I remember times Kitty would drop us off at the YMCA to play basketball, or when we got old enough, we would drive ourselves to the lake or for some one-on-one basketball and swim. Alex and I had a number of classes in school together and shared many lunches playing sports and downing the most unhealthy things we could find while having the time of our lives. I think we probably survived on Coke, Little Debbie's, and French fries most of our high school years. We'll always think of our senior prom and the wonderful time we had. We went to a nice restaurant like most would on a prom night, and I was always the instigator about praying over our food when we ate. So when we prayed that night together for our food, an elderly couple said we reminded them of when they went to prom and paid for our entire meal. I thought that was one of the coolest things that ever happened. Then another time after church, some of us guys went to McDonald's to eat. When we arrived, there was a box full of food on the countertop. We asked what the story was. They said someone called in the order but never picked it up. So just being the silly bunch we were, we asked them if we could have it. They actually let us walk away with stacks of burgers and fries. Nothing like free food for hungry young men. We had times, great times as a group. Alex, Jason, who's here with us, Cruz, Andre, Daniel, Dwight, probably back a lot of memories, Jason. And I keep going to the lake, to concerts, out to eat in the church at Gap Hill in my old Ford. And I'd just like to add that Alex gave his heart to the Lord at Gap Hill and was baptized there as well. Alex was a man of many questions, especially when it came to stuff about God. I was able to pray with him many times about different problems he was facing and life decisions. I also had the honor of teaching him about Jesus and discipling him in his walk with the Lord for the main season we spent together. I will miss him dearly and appreciated every opportunity we had to spend together and the gift God gave me and Alex. God knew we needed each other for the season we had, so I will always look back with joy knowing that we made the most of the time we had. I'll always love you, Alex, and always will love you. So just a couple of thoughts I wanted to share. Alex will be greatly missed. I think the biggest thing I'd like to leave with you today is the fact that how much God loves all of us. He's a merciful God. He showed us his great love by sending Jesus to the cross to die for our sins and shortcomings. We just simply need to receive him. The shortest verse in the Bible is still one of the most powerful. Jesus wept. His compassion is great toward his people. And someone has said that grief never ends, but it changes. It's a passage, not a place to stay. Grief is not a sign of weakness, nor a lack of faith. It's the price of life. Ronnie and Kitty and family, may God give you strength, peace, and comfort during this time. One thing I want to let y'all know about Alex is always
smiling down the top of the right now. Just because he's shocked that I'm there, but I showed up. He gave us such a hard day today. You know, he's trying to blow this stuff off, you know. But it's what Steve's, love Steve and I are saying, laugh about it. And you see the flower all up and down, you talk to Kathy about that. But, yeah, that's about all I got to say about that. I'm glad I was fortunate to be out here. I think he had a little part in that too to help me out here, because I'm not from here at all. Not living here at the time.
person today, but there was a prior family commitment planned. I am a volunteer with NAMI AOP, the National Alliance on Mental Illness, Anderson, Oconee, Pickens. NAMI is the nation's largest grassroots organization dedicated to improving the lives of those with mental illness and their families through education, support, and advocacy. We've been in existence for over 35 years. In January of 2014, I met Ronnie and Kitty. They had signed up to take the NAMI's free 12-week course called Family to Family. It's for families who have an adult relative with a mental illness. It was at that time I met Alex through the eyes of his parents. Mental illness affects 25% of the population in a given year. That's 1 in 4 people. So if we have 100 people in a room, 25 people have either a diagnosable mental illness or have a family member who does. I'm referring to the illnesses such as depression, bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, obsessive compulsive disorder, panic disorder, anxiety disorder, post-traumatic stress disorder, just to name a few. Mental illnesses are biological brain disorders. They are not due to character flaw or lack of willpower. Let me read that again. Mental illnesses are biological brain disorders. They're not due to a character flaw or lack of willpower. Nobody stood at the checkout line and said, hey, give me some of that the bipolar disorder and add a side order of anxiety. They're real medical illnesses. But unfortunately, at this time, we don't have any blood tests or x-rays to prove that they exist. The diagnosis is usually based on the behaviors that we observe. And that's why many people think if the ill person just tried harder, or the parents would be stricter, this would be all be under control. But that's not the case. We call mental illness the no-casserole illness. If someone we know has surgery or a cancer diagnosis, we bend over backwards to support and help them and bring them casserole. If someone we know struggles with mental illness, that family better know how to cook because nobody wants to show up at the door with food. As we gather here today to celebrate Alex's life, many of you have questions and nagging thoughts. You may be uncomfortable from the standpoint that you certainly want to support Ronnie, Kitty, Lane, Angie, and Laura. But what do you say? It's never easy that someone loses a child. But what about the worst case scenario? Dare we say the word suicide out loud? We do in NAMI. We talk about the elephant in the room. Fear hides in the dark. It perpetuates shame and stigma and guilt. When we bring these once taboo subjects, mental illness and suicide, out into the light, we can talk about them and share our concerns. There's not a person who has a relative with a mental illness who hasn't worried that this will happen to the family. What needs to be pointed out is that no one is to blame, and you're not alone. You might be thinking, how could this happen? Ronnie and Kitty did so many things right. They were educated about Alex's illness, and they supported him. And the big thing is that they loved him in despite of the difficult times. What about Alex? Was he weak? How could he do this to his family who loved him so much? The illness was bigger than he was. This was the only way he knew to stop the pain he and his family were experiencing. What we must remember is to celebrate the bravery and courage Alex showed all those years just to be able to get out of bed, and put one foot in front of another. We could get away from the illness for a while. He could not. So when you wonder, what do you say? Ask Ronnie and Kitty, Lane, Angie, and Laura if there's anything you can do for them. Tell them you love them. Bring them a casserole. Ronnie and Kitty, if there's anything I can do for you, let me know. I love you. Michelle. And if there's anything any of us in Nami can do, let us know. Just as a follow-up, those of us who suffer from mental illness or deal with mental illness in any way, shape, or form, realize that one of the tips is self-medication. Self-medicating to deal with the pain. And self-medication comes in all kinds of ways, shapes, and forms. I'm honored to be here today, and I'm honored that you're facing this tragedy and helping those of us go forward. The last 50 years has been a triumph to diabetes, cancer, heart disease. We pray and hope that the next 50 years will be the same to mental illness.
Appreciated your words. I'm Vince Allen. Good to meet you. And we just had a fella from New Zealand staying at our house.
Is that right?
Fella, he's about 27 years old.